We don't need no water. Let the motherfucker burn. Burn, motherfucker.
So we'll take a few minutes, we'll talk about climate change. As you guys can probably, you know, most people are experiencing climate change now. That's sort of one of the bigger issues is that we're seeing big fluctuations in the jet stream. So we're getting drastic changes in our weather. We have one of the warmest winter weathers just this year. 2 years ago we had one of the most snows ever. So we're getting these big fluctuations in global patterns. So 1 year we got no snow and Europe got hammered with feet and feet in snow. And as we were talking about, the big problem with weather is our food supply. So just the other day, California got a freeze, and we get a lot of produce from California. So they're worried about different products not coming to market, which will affect our food supply. Same thing happens in Florida. We get a frost down in Florida. First thing that goes is all the oranges. Prices go up immediately for some reason. So our big scare here is just food production. If the weather hits a particular time of the year and we're about to gather our crops, we won't have enough to get out, and then people will go hungry. And this will go for everything from wheat to corn to just fresh produce that we depend on. So climate change is dramatically, we're in a big flux. We're in a big period where things are just undisturbed. Don't know if it's a normal cycle, but right now we're in a pretty wavy cycle that can possibly affect us for the future, and there's no end in sight. It's not like we're going to say it's going to be fixed next year. And that's this whole scary part of it. We don't know when it's going to be, when the Earth can absorb all this CO2. Of course, the biggest thing that humans are doing is just burning fossil fuels. So, our factory, our industrialization, and the point now is that the United States has gone through industrialization and the rest of the world is now catching up to us. So we have China wanting to produce, and they're producing a lot of air pollution from industry. And then we got cars, which most people are in contact with driving daily in the United States. You go back 30 years, maybe people had one car per family. Now we have 5 cars in the household. So the amount of gasoline people are using has gone up, leading to air pollution. It was one of the major issues, at least that the average person can take on. Climate change affects everybody. That's sort of the big problem with this global change is there's no one that's not going to be affected.
This is the year. Esto es el año, ¿no? Cerremos la planta. That we can close this plant, we have to think that this is the year. We are going to end coal in Chicago.
Although there is no clear end in sight, there is much that we can do to prevent from destroying ourselves, our environment, and our Earth. The very things on this earth that allow life to sustain itself are as simple as the tiniest blade of grass and the smallest droplet of water. Those are what make this planet, Earth, unique from all others. To sustain life, we need to preserve these delicate intricacies of nature.
So global changes, what can people do? There's always, you can take a whole country or you can take people individually, and it's always important to just start with individual people. So we start in Connecticut. Again, we have a lot of rivers in Connecticut. We do have a lot of dams generating hydroelectric, and we need to utilize them and use them on a daily basis. A lot of them not always running, so we need to use them daily. The water's moving, and we can generate a lot of clean, renewable energy. And that won't produce any pollution, air pollution from our hydroelectric plants is one good key that we can do. Another one is just transportation. Way back when You know, most people had one car per family. Now you look out and people have five cars. Look at I-84 is packed. So we need to start looking at transportation, start using high energy efficient cars to move from place to place where the energy consumption and mileage is high at 40, 50 miles per gallon. That will dramatically reduce the amount of air pollution from cars. A last good thing that people can do is just use the sun. Even though some of our photovoltaic cells are not 100% efficient, they're getting to the point where, you know, if we put them on every building and every resident, and if we start collecting the sun, which we have enough sun energy to produce enough energy to run all our energy needs for the whole world every day. So if we start collecting and utilizing energy from the sun in small quantities, we can start adding these little pieces up here and there, and eventually people will have enough energy to want what they need on a daily basis. So putting photovoltaic cells on houses, there won't be any air pollution from generating electricity, because we'll make it on a daily basis and we can send it wherever we need to go. And then if we make extra, people can actually sell that energy back to the power plants. So right now that is a good future. Right now it's in the potential, but we know that the sun produces enough energy that we can use it on a daily basis. So that is a good goal that the government and people in Connecticut should be working toward, and promoting use of solar energy.
Hydropower has environmental impacts which are very different from those of fossil fuel power plants. The actual effects of the dams and reservoirs on various ecosystems are only now becoming understood. The future of hydroelectric power will depend upon the future demand for electricity, as well as how societies value the environmental impacts of the hydroelectric power compared to the impacts of other sources of electricity.
Some might say that creating a hydroelectric dam can hurt the environment. However, with the correct pre-planning, this can be avoided. A correctly built hydroelectric dam can actually help the environment and people downstream. During heavy rains and flooding, the dam operators can slow water from upstream, making sure that water downstream will not flood, endangering wildland, buildings, and people.
So looking at a hydroelectric dam, there are many sizes, many shapes, and the key thing about how they work is just basically gravity feed. It rains up somewhere up in the mountains or somewhere else off the land, water drains into the river, and just the moving water is going to turn a turbine, which is mechanical, and then we generate electricity from. Just like if the power goes out and you have a gas-filled generator, here we're just using the movement of the water to move a big generator inside the hydroelectric dam, and as a result, there's no air pollution. It's clean, and you don't have the air pollution being produced if we were to burn something like coal. It's one of the first major issues that the hydroelectric dam does not have. Also behind hydroelectric dams, you also have a capacity to conserve water. You have water trapped that you can use for agriculture or for drinking water. Is another benefit of hydroelectric dams that people can use.
Hydroelectric energy creates one-fifth of the world's power. Austin, what are those five countries?
Well, a few of the countries are the United States, Canada, China, and some others. This was back in 2004. The U.S. remains one of the top producers, as well as China.
It's about break-even right now. But the future is really where we're pushing. We need research to collect this energy from the sun. I mean, you think about it, plants do it naturally. They do it every day. And if you know, we can study the plants and figure exactly how efficient they are and sort of capture that. Right now we have different metals and different silica products that help capture and get the electrons to move. And then we disperse that into the wires. And the other thing we're working on is also devising a system that, you know, what are we going to do when the sun goes down? So we have to also store that energy. So there's a little bit, you know, we're still working on storing it, but if we could send our electricity, let's say, to another part of the state, you know, because we do have a time difference, that would be beneficial. So there's still a lot going on with solar energy. I mean, think of all the solar lights that you can use just outside in your house that work, that you don't have to take off electricity from the power grid to use. So, I mean, we have them, it's just a matter of magnifying them and letting everybody use them. Some people don't believe in them, and you know, they leave their lights on in their house all day. So the other big thing is just conservation. People need to do little tiny things, and if you start adding up 1% at a time, it's going to make a huge difference. They're doing research on those. So we do have a couple countries working on them. And a lot of them are using it to focus the energy of the sun through mirrors to heat water to make steam. So they're jumping, instead of burning coal to make steam to turn a turbine, they're basically generating hot water through, like you would use a magnifying lens. So it's out there. For example, they're looking at, you know, out in western United States because they get so much sun. And there is a future for that.
Let's take a look at one of the best and most efficient options in consumer sustainable transport, the Chevy Volt.
Began in 2007 when Chevrolet came up with an e-car, electric car, whose range was about 50 or 60 miles. They scrapped this plan and they decided to go ahead with what is called an extended range vehicle, which is what the Volt eventually became. The Volt will go 30 to 50 miles on a single charge, and after that a gas engine kicks in, but the gas engine does not propel the car, it propels a generator, which generates electricity, and the overall range of a Volt is 320 to 350 miles, which is the same as a regular standard car. But you're going to go 350 miles on about 9 gallons of gas. So during the first 35 to 50 miles when you're on electricity, there is absolutely no emissions going into the air. If you're like myself, who drives less than 30 miles in a day, there's a chance I would never burn any gasoline. It would be a pure electric car at that point. It's also very luxurious. It gives you all the amenities you'd get in almost any other car. It handles beautifully. It's got 150 horsepower and it's got 273 pound-foot of torque, which is actually neck throttling. This car is a rocket ship in many ways. The suspension is based on the Corvette suspension, so it handles like a Mini Cooper, like it's on rails. It's a very, very unique, beautiful car. Also was tested for 2 years in a wind tunnel to make sure it aerodynamically was beyond any other car that's out there today. They even go as far as to use low resistance rolling tires that add to the gas mileage of the car. It is a unique and car. It's just a terrific car for this day and this century. It is the future of the vehicle. The Volt's price is not bad considering. They start at about $39,000, they come up to about $45,000, fully loaded with navigation and leather. But the government is offering for the first 200,000 sold a $7,500 tax credit. Not a deduction, but a credit. So that brings the price down into the low 30s, which is reasonable and similar to what a Prius may go for. It's similar to driving a golf cart, if you've ever done that. But as you will see when I bring you out and let you drive one, it's quite a golf cart.
We cut the leg